The beads anyway.
I'm partying. We're partying here. Tom, aren't okay. You a party animal, aren't you?
All right. Okay, folks, I'm Tom Vassell, and this is Steven Buonocore from Stronghold Games.
Is there a reason why you're so, like, calm and not like, hey, I'm Tom Vassell?
Because there are people playing a game here, and we're trying not to bother them.
All right, okay. And it's 9 o'clock in the morning.
Move your mic up a little bit higher, probably, just so people can hear you. We don't want to... Yeah,
hold my coffee.
I will hold your coffee.
There's a production assistant coming in.
Got to get on camera. Somehow, he's got to get himself on camera.
Alrighty, folks. Well, anyway, we are at the Gathering of Friends. And the Gathering of Friends is a small convention hosted by Alan R. Moon, designer of Ticket to Ride and many other games. He started this 20-plus years ago.
Almost 30, I think.
And he basically invited his friends. It's a lot of industry people come. It's an invite-only convention, but don't feel bad if you can't be here because we're going to tell you everything interesting that happened here.
I hope so.
Well, we'll find out. This is also your chance to talk to Mr. Buonocore and ask him questions and or me questions. In the link in the video, there's a link to Q&A where you can go and ask questions and you can upvote other people's questions. And so Steve will not be the only person on the channel today. We're also going to try to do this more. We're going to try to do it on Thursday and Saturday, too. I don't think we'll do it Friday.
But I'll be the most interesting person on the channel.
There's a possibility that's not true because we have here other publishers who are also very interesting and we have designers who are interesting. In fact, I believe if we went through every person at the show, you would be in the top 400 interesting people.
Of the 401 people that are here. Only person less interesting is Jason.
That's reasonable. No? Wow. No, I would put Jason over you.
Jason would be above me.
Okay. Anyhow. All right, Zee. Do we have any questions from people? All right, so don't forget, if you want to ask a question. Oh, does the sound check okay, by the way? Okay, remember, if you're watching this later on or you're not on the live streaming, me and Mr. Buonocore are on two different channels, so if you're only listening in one headphone, you might only hear one of us. So
we're in stereo.
We are in stereo.
Oh,
we could sing. I don't know what song.
Want to sing?
So, okay.
I'm not sure my singing voice is yet here at 9 a.m., but we can try it. Oh, whatever you want to do. Ignoring me is very normal for people, yes.
All right, so here we go. This one's pretty good. I'm going right from the top.
Yeah.
And the first question is, will Derek's role within the Dice Tower be limited to video editing, or will he also assist with reviews and other on-camera work?
All right. Yeah, I will. The question is Derek's role going to be just video editing or will it be more than that? It will definitely be more than that. In fact, Derek is going to be helping us a lot with audio right now. In fact, maybe even today while we're doing this. I know he's setting up our microphones. We're using these, but I do want to make one thing clear. A lot of people have said in the past, oh, it looks like your new video editor isn't doing a good job. That's because he hadn't started yet. He just started this week, started today. He just moved in last week, and we have actually found somebody who has more junk than Jason. So, Jason, you're number two now.
He moved into your house, too?
No,
he
moved...
like 400
No. We helped him
move... So, by the gathering of family...
We moved him into his house.
Oh, okay.
But he had, like, video games and comic books. There was a lot of... It was...
I have the...
Yeah. I thought Jason was the only person I'd move VHS tapes for.
VHS? I have the privilege of... staying at Jason's house in about a month or so, right? And that's going to be interesting to see what that's like.
And So anyway, Derek will be starting this week, and his duties and things will, you'll see stuff. You might not see him as much, but hopefully you'll see a major change in the channel as in incremental steps, of course. All right, we got anything for Buonocore?
It's okay. I can just heckle you. That's fine.
There's very few people watching.
There's very few. Nobody cares. Why did I get up for this?
It's the time. Okay, so far, my favorite game that's new, because I played some games I like already. My favorite game that's new, I'm going to go with the Munchkin collectible card game. I really did enjoy that. It was fun.
Cool. I haven't played it. That's a cool choice, though. I want to see how that plays.
I like the bluffing aspect. Basically, you say, I'm attacking you with this card, and then they'll say, I'm going to block that, or they'll be like, you're lying, okay? Because you can put any card down, and if you're lying, then you take a damage.
I'm meeting with Kevin after this, Kevin Wilson after this, and I have lunch with Eric Lang after that, so
yeah.
I can't wait
I think some people are going to find the Munchkin CCG, and they're going to go Munchkin, or they're going to go CCG. You know, they're going to knock them both off for different reasons, but I don't think you should. I've always thought the Munchkin humor is funny. It's just that it was overdone, done, time and time again. So,
right.
But the game itself I thought was pretty fun.
Cool. Now, I'm not being self-serving, but I play the games. Here he goes. The games that I play here are obviously prototypes and stuff that I'm already announced that I'm publishing.
So you don't play other people's games?
No, I do when I can, but I'm having my strategic meetings like with Eggers Bieler, right? I've had basically the first 2 days are almost like all meetings with them because we're talking
about
the games.
We got it. Thank you.
We're talking about the games that we're doing, and a couple of games I announced I had never even played because the Great Western Trail, for instance, and Jorvik, there was nothing there except for they showed me the art, told me about the game.
You announced games that you haven't played?
When I announced the strategic partnership with Eggers Bieler.
Oh, you announced a partnership, I see.
Right.
Okay.
And these were the game as part of the partnership. I'm doing all of their games. So as part of that, they announced these games. I got a chance to play the prototypes here. And the Great Western Trail is unbelievably good. It's a big, heavy, meaty Euro. It's got a little bit of a deck-building element. It's got resource management in it.
Is it better than Kanban?
It's very, very, very ridiculously different. You don't have the mental capacity to play heavy Euros. I'm sorry. So that's your problem.
I asked a straightforward question. There was no snark in there.
If you think Kanban is not a brilliant design.
First of all, I did not say that. I was asking if you thought it was it better than Panamax, which I have played.
You said
and
Kanban.
Apparently I have the mental capacity for that one.
Yeah, that one's a little lighter than Kanban, so you might be able to, you know, get your head
around
that.
Where would
you
put the
The weight? What?
Wow, I apologize. I guess it's time for our next guest.
Have I made him speechless? Come on.
No, where would you put its weight complexity, the new one?
Great Western Trail. Below Kanban, above Panamax, in that area. I mean, it's a big. Eggers Bieler uses a paw.
Who's the designer?
It's Pfister, who did Mombasa. Alexander Pfister did Mombasa. I forgot his other design, but that was a big one last year. He's really up-and-coming designer. Really, really good. Port Royal.
What? So it's like Port Royal. Cool. I like Port Royal.
He's doing really well, and those who like his designs and those who like big meaty games, you're going to really like this one. So, that one.
All right, Steve, I've got a couple of questions for you here. Don't forget to repeat them one at a time.
Mm-hmm.
One question is, how will craft the wagon be different from craft?
Kraftwagen.
Okay, so the question is, how would Kraftwagen D6?
V6, that's the new edition. Have I officially announced that? How did they know that? Things get out before they truly get out. There'll be a press release about the game. The difference between Kraftwagen, or Kraftwagen, and Kraftwagen V6 is that there's a built-in expansion. The V6... What's wrong? Take it easy.
No, I understand that. I think it's funny that he gets all excited. I'm not laughing at you.
Will you take it easy over there? Jason is insane.
He's very paranoid on these shows. Have you noticed? He's like, anything I do, he's like, what are you laughing at? I was laughing at Jason. You're fine.
Don't touch me. It's very creepy. Anyway, so Kraftwagen V6 is a... we'll have basically the next technology, because it's about the very early automotive market in Germany, obviously, and throughout Europe. The rise of Benz, Daimler-Benz, and that era. And the end of that is the V6 engine. So we're adding the V6. It's called the V6 Edition. So the V6 expansion is part of the game. And there'll be another set of tiles, specialty tiles, that are in the game. That's what's the difference. You like it? Good. Jason likes it. Jason gives his approval. Hello. Some other very important people are here, much more important than Tom.
For you.
Oh, this is good. I one time had him show me on his thing, like, which podcast do you listen to?
Which podcast?
I know he listens to a lot.
I don't listen to my own one anymore. I don't listen to it because I'm on it.
The first one on here is a podcast that doesn't even exist anymore.
It's just there. It doesn't exist. It's obviously mine is on here. I download them. Podcast Nonsense with Gamers, Rolling Dice and Taking Names, Garrett's Gaming Geekies.
His number one podcast is his own. Yeah.
Well, it's in alphabetical order, you jerk.
This guy is really... Wow, I agree with... Oh, he's wrong here.
Garrett's Gaming Geekies, Heavy Cardboard, The Spiel, Dice Tower, Showdown, which... Is it even going anymore?
Recording. They should be launching.
Blue Peg, Pink Peg, one of my favorites. Geek All-Stars, a little long. The Party Game Cast, I love party games. This one here that I don't want to even talk about. Dice Tower. Secret Cabal, my boys, D6 Generation. Should I keep going?
Essentially, he listens to all of them. Although, there's no way you can listen to all of them. So what do you do on that?
I listen to all of them at two times.
Oh, you listen at two times speed?
I absolutely do. So you're much more interesting at two times speed.
Well, I'm not going to. I believe if we go back and replay this interview, I was nicer to him than
I have to take my shots while you're tired. Otherwise, I think he's right so
far. Yes. All right, let's go back to Q&A.
Well, one more. People want to hear about the Dark Moon expansion.
Well, everyone's picking up on, like, it's nothing like, you know, what's already out or, you know, what's coming out. But, of course, it's all the stuff that... is almost not announced
so
yet.
So you're basically upset that people want to know what's coming out.
No, it's just funny that those little breadcrumbs.
Dude, we live in the cult of the future. People want to know what's coming.
We really do. And I tweeted, what was it? What's today? Tuesday. So I tweeted on Sunday night about that we were playing Dark Moon with the.
Remember the mic? We'll pick you up fine.
With the new unannounced expansion, and immediately the Twitter feed started going. And I was playing that with Ignacy Chevychek, who happens to be sitting in the wings here, coming on next. And again, I guess in brief, some of the things that are added, the tentative title is Shadow Corporation, Dark Moon Shadow Corporation. So there'll be a escape shuttle that you can possibly get on as another endgame condition to leave the space station that you're on, the planet that you're on, rather. There's going to be another role, the company man. Think of Paul Reiser from Alien, right? So he's got his own agenda in there, so it's sort of a third faction kind of thing. So that's about all I really want to say about it. I probably shouldn't say anything until it's like we actually have started laying out the print files and stuff. But if you like Dark Moon...
Well, what's a time frame for when we would see this?
I'm going to try to get it this year. I don't like to sit on things.
How many... I mean, what's your current like roster for 2016? You have a lot, right? I think it's like 15 or so?
Closer to 20.
Closer to 20.
Well,
wow.
It's at the moment announced it's like 15, but you know, I still have some things that aren't announced yet, so let's say between 15 and 20 in that range.
All right, what do we got?
Okay, one quick question for you, and this dude might not even know. People want to know when they can buy the Great Western Trailer.
Yeah, it's an Essen release, so you know. We should have it simultaneously
the question
in the
here
U.S.
Is, the question here is, when is the Great Western Trail going to be released?
Sorry. We should have it in stores in October, end of October, the same time as you'd have it in Europe. Could be like November, but that's about the time frame.
As a publisher, how do you handle the occasional negative reviews?
I take them very personally.
He calls up. I hear just some weeping on the phone. The question is, as a publisher, how does he handle the occasional, very rare, negative review?
Who would ever review one of my games negatively? But no, you do take them personally. I admit, you will. You take them personally. Tom loves when I come to him and say, like, you just completely missed the point of the game. You don't know what you're talking about. But, you know, not every game is for every person. That's just...
Okay, well, let me ask you this.
What
do you do if a majority of the reviews aren't very positive?
I don't think I have that issue, but, you know, you get...
It's okay, but, I mean, it might happen as time goes by.
What would I do? I don't know. Just keep...
Do you read all the comments on BoardGameGeek? Like, do you look at all the ratings and read all the comments?
Oh, no. I don't look at ratings and read. I'll look at the rating, but I won't look at the comments and the no.
Do you, like, read and watch every review?
If it's on BoardGameGeek, I will find them, and I will, yes.
So you subscribe to a game and any kind of...
I subscribe to all my games. I think that's a good idea for a publisher to see what people are saying so that I know when, whatever, somebody says, hey, I
Have you ever,
I don't
like,
understand this.
Have you ever watched a review or read a review and you're like, huh, maybe I should change that in this game for the second edition or something?
I mean, sometimes the comments are good and you might want to, and or I mean, a lot of times it's FAQ kind of stuff, right? So there's comments that people aren't getting. It's the same thing, question to question. So boom, let's get that into the FAQ.
When a review is super positive, do you like? Are you having a great day then?
Of course. I mean, it always feels good, you know, because you do. I mean, these are like, you know, your children. I mean, your time and effort and, you know, money into these things, so you want them to be happy. You want them to be good. And the one game here that Jason and I were talking about this before, that's getting such great buzz. And the game, you know, the game's not out. It's Animals on Board. There's this little, you know, it's like family. It's a spill the jar weight game. But all the gamers here are like, oh my God, this is so great. So it's that has made me feel, that's one of those like surprises that, you know, I haven't been hearing. I brought in some copies of that and brought in some copies of My Village. I flew them over just to have them here. And people are just like, the Animals on, no one's seen it yet. That's why. So people are really, really talking about it. That makes me really happy.
That was a 30 seconds or so of your allotted.
Was my 30-second allotted
plug. I told him he had 5 minutes worth of plugs total. All right, so people have questions about Buonocore's local game group. You live in New Jersey.
I live in New Jersey. What I do is I run a bi-weekly group of gamers that gets together at my house, and I have another bi-weekly group that gets together at my house for lighter games. So I have like the sort of the gamer game group, and there's crossover between the two, and then the sort of the lighter, that's when we get together with like sort of couples, and a lot of them aren't true gamers, but we'll play like party games, Catchphrase and Code Names and things like that. So those are my two ongoings, but essentially once a week. And then we have the general playtesting stuff that I do, that I wouldn't call that a group. That's just like some couple of people come over, we have to play test something. So that.
Speaking of lighter games, have you guys got to play Code Names Pictures? People want to hear about that. What do you thought if you got to play it?
I don't think...
He's asking about Code Names Pictures.
I don't think... I haven't played it yet, but I don't know that we're allowed to... People are asking about Code Names Pictures. I don't know if people... I don't know we're allowed to say much about it yet. I need to check with the CG guys about how much of it is allowed to be talked about. Yeah. We'll know on the next one. We'll try to get a CG guy in here.
I think it's... Basically, everyone knows it's Code Names with pictures.
Yeah, probably. But I don't know how much more we can say.
Yeah, that's what it is. And I haven't played it yet myself, and I am a huge fan of Codenames. All right, Jason says it's amazingly awesome. Take that for what it is.
Okay, so what we're going to do here is we're going to do a little bit
break.
Of...
break. Steven's going to leave. Right?
No, no, we're not. We're going to do a little bit of merry-go-rounding here.
Merry-go-rounding.
So I'm going to let Ignacy come on with you, and I won't be here briefly, but I am off-screen hovering, ready to come in and whop you up one.
Ignacy and I are a much better team than you and me, so...
And then I'm going to kick you out.
All right. All the people are loving your song.
You want to put this as high as you can.
Look at this. This is, oh, nice, comfortable. I look taller than you because you're slouching. This guy's 6.5 feet tall.
Hello, hello.
Check, check, check.
Hello, hello. You got some chimney check.
And this is Steven Buonocore, and we are Board Games Insider.
Tommy's still on the screen. What's going on?
Oh, yeah, this is very, some kind of lag going on here.
Here at the gathering, I played the Dark Moon with expansion, and it was super fun experience because it's a social game, so you're like trash talking for 2 hours, and it was hilarious.
What did you call me while we were playing that game?
There was a couple of things that I'm not supposed to say publicly.
He said you act ridiculous.
And
I was not infected. And everyone didn't believe me.
Yes, and Tom made me play very dry Euro, which was very good, but very dry. Hotel Austria, what's the name of the game?
Grand Hotel
Austria. Yes, very solid, very good game, but very dry. Okay. Very Stefan Feldish, I would say.
Okay.
But very good game. This kid's game, very good, yes.
Automania? Okay, that was good.
He was talking about Automania.
Yeah, no, yeah, yeah. Being serious is a very fun game, strategy game, but rather lighter.
Okay.
Okay, guys, a question for both of you. And I think you've been here for the gathering before.
Many times, yeah.
And you haven't been here before.
I'm the first timer.
That's the red badge is the first timers.
This is red, this is pink.
But yeah, like those pants you're wearing.
This is red.
Like those pants you're wearing, they're kind of pink. I'm very skeptical about that color. The blue ones are publishers, but even a publisher will start with pink, and then he'll get this next year, and you guys will get white, I guess, white. And then the people who've been here for 20 plus years are black badges. It's very cool. And Janet is purple. Janet Moon is purple badge. She's the only one, I think it's purple badge.
All right, so the question is, how do you guys compare Gathering of Friends to other events you've been to?
Okay, the question is, how do we compare this to other conventions, other gatherings of gamers. It is unique. This is a truly unique situation. You're essentially just here to play games for whatever length of time it is, 8 days. Of course, Ignacy and I trying to get together to podcast, I had to take out my schedule. And like, I can't schedule. No, I got a meeting. I got this. So there's a lot of business being done here because I don't get to see Ignacy, you know, very often. I don't get to see my friends at Eggerspiele very often. We have business to take care of. So it for the publishers, for the industry people, a lot of business is getting done, but the business is all around gaming, of course. I've met with Eggerspiele now for like, you know, 8 hours or so on playing their games, the games that we're doing together. It's a very different vibe. There are many people who just come here and just game the whole time. But a very social environment because there's no events, essentially, one or two things, but it's supposed to be a very relaxed, just game, socialize with your friends atmosphere.
Because we have no booth here, so there's no like actual work at the booth, which changes a lot. I think this is my only convention in the year where I don't have a booth, so I don't have to be on the stand and playing with games, the domain games, I'm just playing games with friends.
Yes.
And I don't do business meetings like this guy, so I'm just playing games. The difference, yes. And I'm presenting prototypes and playing games, just like that.
Well, we sort of have a business meeting.
We had
today
like
at 3 o'clock, and then we had one sort of yesterday, a little.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is Portal going to be at Origins?
Portal is going to be at Origins. We have a Crazy Cars release there, so we are going to release a game there for the first time for us. There will be Chevy as our Portal representative there, and there will be two people from Poland going to Origins, so we will have a booth, we will have a couple of people there representing us, and we will have a new game there, so yes.
Okay. Are you involved with Terraforming Mars?
Yes, Stronghold Games.
The other Mars game.
Yeah. Stronghold Games is releasing the other Mars game.
People are asking for you to elaborate on Terraforming Mars a little bit, if there's anything you can tell. But like, I think it's interesting that you're both coming out with Mars games.
Everybody's coming with Mars game this year.
Mars is
like
a hot,
everybody, yeah.
Mars is a hot topic right now. We've got First Martians, right? First Martians, which is a riff on the Robinson Crusoe system, which sounds just amazing. So that's and I'm going to talk about both of our games.
Yeah.
And so that, right, that's sort of like you just got to Mars, sort of like the Martian, the movie, right? Just got there and you have to survive on Mars, which is really cool. And in terraforming wise, let's go 400 years into the future, where you now, you're a corporation trying to terraform the planet, exploit, not in a bad way, you're trying to change the planet's atmosphere, right? We're going to have to add CO2 to raise the temperature. You have to introduce crops. You have to raise animals and stuff like that. Build things on the planet such that we can sustain life on the planet going forward. Lots of card play, like 300 cards in the game. And a very modular design, because you can start with the basic game and play it in a short amount of time, or you can bring it up to the intermediate level. I forget we have names to these levels. Or you can go the full bore out. It's a very big, like about 2.5 hour game with all of the stuff in there. So
is this game here, by the way?
Oh no, it is not. It will be in release, I believe. We're gonna have it at Gen Con. So
probably, sample copies, something like that.
No sample copies here. Sorry.
So we have to trust that the game is awesome.
Did you have to trust
that
the game is
awesome?
The buzz is good. The buzz is good on BGG. The people who have played the prototype think it's good. Do you want to?
I just wanted to check it.
You're gonna pick on me like Tom picks on me now. Come on. Let's have Mary over here.
He's not nice to me either. I'm going to have Ignacy's wife.
This is
on
the
it.
Spot, you know.
This is the mean spot. This is the mean spot.
Yeah, but the couch is very like.
People change that approach now.
Okay, guys, question for you.
Hey, guys! Oh, Mike Fitzgerald, famous designer behind us.
Wow, you got enough.
Yeah, so I'm all blinged out.
I guess you are.
What did you have to do for those
beads? Oh, I can't say that. Z asked me.
But
what
I didn't went for that. I don't have them.
I'm not allowed to say that on Dice Tower Network what I had to do to get the beads.
Okay, got it. Question for you guys. How do you feel about language independent versus language dependent games?
I'm for language dependent.
He's for language dependent. You said that in the past.
You're making.
You play the new era, there's the game with the icons that no one understands, even the designer, yes?
Well, your company is making a move,
a very, very, very move. Absolutely. We are done with icons. Yesterday we played this Cafe Austria Hotel something, and we were just checking the rulebook all the time to check how this card works. I hate it.
I normally like, language independent games. It makes it easier, to do printing runs, for instance, because when you print with your partner, everything is the same except for the rule book. But there is the problem, of course, iconography is always going to be a big deal. So, I mean, I guess it's a bit dependent on the game. I mean, most games that I have put out have text on cards, and that's going to, that's going to make it less non-language independent. So, you need language on those cards sometimes and on components, so you do what you can do.
I had a situation when I was playing my own game and I was checking rulebook what this icon means because I didn't remember. So this is like, it makes no sense.
That's a problem.
Yeah.
Okay, guys, legacy games. Because of the amount of
legacy games
that goes into a legacy game because of how difficult they are to sort of play fast and streamline, you guys think they're a fad? Do you think they are here to stay? Tell me a little bit about them.
The question is about legacy games. What do we think about them? Are they here to stay?
I understand his English. Like,
well, but they didn't understand.
I'm fine.
We need you to repeat the question. That's pretty weird. I'm just not good at even that.
You go first. Like,
I think the concept is amazing. As you guys know, I have a roots in role-playing games, so creating stories, creating campaigns, playing scenario after one, after another, building experience of players. And legacy games offer that. So we can play strategy game, we can play board game, but with this campaign feeling, with story developing over one game and over one game, and first Martians, we have a campaign. And as most of you already know, because designers says that in interviews, playtesting this is a super difficult stuff, because if you have a campaign that has a couple of scenarios, testing scenario 3 means that you have to play test first, second, 3. You finish the 3 once again, 1, 2, 3, and you go over and over and over again, because playtesting scenario number 3 or 4, you have to set up the situation after the previous one. So this is super difficult to playtest, but for players, hopefully it will be super immersive, engaging, and Pandemic Legacy proved that.
Yes. I love legacy games. I think this is the only reason it's not going to become bigger than it really, really big is because of the amount of work it takes. But I think we're going to see more and more and more legacy games. I think the experience that you get when you play a game like that is just incredible. I'm in the middle of Pandemic Legacy right now, and I'm loving every minute of it. So yes, more and more legacy games. I think it's going to be a bigger trend, and it's not going to be exactly what we see now. I think it's going to change over time. You're going to have that legacy element in games and not even called a legacy thing. Things will change in a game permanently, but it won't be called a legacy game. It won't be as big and deep and wild as the current ones that we've seen.
Okay, people want to know a little bit about your gaming tastes. What are some of your favorite games from this last year?
What are some of our favorite games from this past year? From this past year.
Mm. Past year.
Okay.
Blood Rage? Well,
yeah, oh, that's a that was great. Yes.
Blood Rage. And for me, Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective, which was technically 2014, but I played it last year. So for me, it was 2015, and it blew my mind.
those two. Pandemic Legacy, definitely. I'm going to add into that as a, just an amazing, amazing game. Just trying to think what else I loved. Codenames was last year.
Yep.
Phenomenal. The simplest game. You know, they took just that simple, simple concept and just blew it out of the water. Love it. Blood is great.
That was really, really very good year last year. Like, there was a couple of really very interesting games.
Yeah. No, I think it was a fantastic year. I think every year is just going to be more and more fantastic.
Have you played Watson at
Holmes? No, not yet.
You might like that.
Yep.
It's the same idea, but split out over time.
I saw it here, so I can try it this week.
They're talking about Watson and Holmes.
All right, we're doing some switching here.
All right, they're gonna throw me out now.
Oh, that's awful.
They're going to switch me with Jason. I'll let you determine if that's a good switch. All right, guys, take care. I'm going to be off right now. Help me out, Jason. Help me out. Assistant to the producer.
Yeah,
there you go.
Get the mic.
Bye, guys.
Over here.
All right, man. Thanks.
Let me hook up the mic. Speaking of legacy, while I hook up the mic here, First Martian's a legacy. So
sort of, yeah.
Sort of a legacy. Can you talk about it a little bit, what you're going to do with it?
So the element of legacy in the First Martian is that you play in campaign. There is no components, like destroying components, there's no stickers, there's no that part of legacy mechanics, because at this moment, because this is all new stuff, we don't have an actual definition what the legacy means, yes? If this is the stickers on the board, or this is the campaign mode, what we talk about, right? First Martian has a campaign mode. You will have three campaigns in the box. Each campaign is about five scenarios, so we are developing the story for over the next scenarios, and you have adventures, and you have experience points for your characters, you get new skills, but there is no, you know, opening a box and having new components, there's no stickers, no that kind of stuff.
But you did it through the computer and an app instead. Yeah. So I know you were telling me the other day how the app kind of tracks what you do, so if you make a decision in the first game, the app will know that you made that decision.
Yeah. So basically, the simplest example, you are going to explore some part of the Mars, you have an accident, the rover just triples, yes, you smash your head over the glass, yes, and you have an adventure, you have these problems, you hit your head, you have a headache, but you don't know what else. And the app remembers that, the app shuffles that. Three turns later, the app says you have some really big problems with concentrations. You have to take a token of rerolling every test because you have really dizzy. Yes, you better go to the medic. Do you go to the medic? Because at this moment, probably players have no time for that because they have all the different problems. So the player says, "I don't go to the medic because we have different problems." So he says, "No, I'm not going. I'm okay. I'm fine." The app remembers that he didn't went to the medic because he was stupid. So the next round, their app says, "Hey, go to the medic because you are really, really feeling not very bad." The player says, "No, I don't have time for that. No, I'm not going to bed." Once again, the app, two rounds later, the app says, "Man, you are losing action point because you are really, really feeling bad." So the app is remembering consequences, what you do, what you do, what you do. Even if you finish the first scenario and you start the second scenario, the app will take all these cards shuffled into the event deck and take them to the second scenario. So in the second scenario, the app will once again remind you, "Hey, you remember the accident you had in the first scenario? Go to the medic app." So with that, we can create a very immersive story that all the things that you did during the scenario will have consequences over and over and over. So the story is built and built.
Yeah, no, I think it sounds great. I mean, I love unique apps and games, and it sounds like you're going to do an amazing job with this app.
This app is a very simple tool to just build a very interesting story that will be developed over the next scenarios and next scenarios and next scenarios, and everything will, you know, have these consequences. It will be very interesting.
So how have you liked it here so far? I mean, we came at the beginning. We've been here since Saturday morning or Friday night. And how do you been enjoying it so far?
I have to say, very interesting stuff here. And I recommend it, by the way, to all conventions over the world. Because we have these badges that we are the first time here, first timers.
Red.
Yes. People who are here not for the first time approach us, welcome us, and, "Hey, you are a first timer. How do you like it? Do you want to join us?" Because they know that we don't know yet people because we are the first time. they approach us and say, hey, come to play with us. So this is a very friendly environment, and it's a very interesting idea to give on different conventions the first-timer's badge, so the other people see, okay, this guy is for the first time, let's help him, you know, socialize.
Yeah.
Very interesting, and I really appreciate that, because many people approach us and say, hey, you're the first time, play with us.
Yeah, that's how I kind of felt. I'm like, everyone's so welcoming. But what's funny is, people have said to me, are you really here for the first time? I thought you've been here before. And I'm like, well, that's kind of nice, but no, I'm really a red badge this year.
But this is very interesting policy of helping people to join the convention.
Yeah, and it's really welcoming. Everyone's welcoming. Do you have a question, Zee, that you were looking at us? As opposed to Steve. Steve, no one wanted to hear you talk. Now there's a lot of questions coming for Ignacy. Oh, but he's picking on me too.
When you are designing a new game, what comes first? Theme, mechanics?
So repeat that.
So when Ignacy is designing a new game, which does he think about first? The theme of the game or the mechanics of the game?
For the most cases, for the biggest titles of mine, so Robinson Crusoe, Stronghold, now First Martians is always a theme. So first I pick a theme that is interesting, then I buy a lot of books, I rent a lot of movies, and for like 4-6 months I'm just researching and learning the stuff and doing notes about the topic, and then I start designing. So at this very moment I'm pretty well educated about the math. So if you want to ask me about math questions, I know stuff. I learned chemistry in English because most of the books I bought are from Amazon.com, so I know them in English, so I know the very strange knowledge about the math, physics, chemistry, because I have to prepare for the actual design. So if you have problems on math, just call me. I know the stuff.
Is it true? Can we actually really colonize Mars in a few years?
There is a very serious project called Mars One, Mars Direct, and this project, Mars Direct, has a very precise plan how to do it. And I read the whole book. It makes sense. Yeah. So it means that it is possible.
So if you guys want to learn about Mars, if you see Ignacy at any convention, just ask him. He can tell you anything you ever want to know about Mars from now on.
At this moment, I'm well prepared.
Okay, Ignacy, one last question for you. When's the new one in Hiroshima Hex coming out? Are there any new ones?
I know, yes.
Yes, yes, yes. Hiroshima Hex, is there new stuff? That's what people want to know. Love the game.
I know Michael Orage is working on the new army. It's called Death Breath, and it's some sort of, not zombies, but some very strange mutants from the world of Hiroshima Hex. I know that he was presenting the prototype at PortalCon, that was in January. So it's working, and now he's balancing the stuff. I don't know when it's ready. I didn't get the files from him yet, but I know it is scheduled for this year for sure, because I know it's working already.
As far as printing the armies for third edition...
Yes, for this year we have scheduled the Dancer and Mephisto, so these are the two fan armies, the fan-created armies.
Yeah.
And
this is for third edition, because you know how second edition all of the expansion armies came out, and now third edition only some of them are out, so Ignacy is going to tell you guys which ones will come out this year.
So Dancer and Mephisto are ready. When I was leaving Poland to come to Gathering of Friends, the files were ready, so probably they are at print now or in a couple of days, and then we will ship them to stay. So I assume the summer time is rather safe bet. And once again, these are armies Mephisto and Dancer. This is very interesting stuff, because these are armies that were designed by fans, put as a print and play files on BGG website, and because they had so many thumbs up and they were so interesting, we contacted the authors and asked them if they are interested to be part of the official line. Of course, they were interested. So they are official armies created by fans of the game, which is very cool.
Yeah, what about, speaking of expansions, Imperial Settlers, you have another expansion coming out very soon.
Freezy Magic Number is already on the boat, and it is scheduled for 25th of May, a street date. So end of the May is a street date for Freezy Magic Number. This is a small Empire pack, 60 cards, and you will be doing set collection. So there is a lot of cards that says, if you have three red cards in your Empire, something happens. So during the draft, you will be looking not only on abilities of the cards, by also the colors of this card, because you try to make some set of colors that will trigger some effects.
Have you been working on more things? Are there going to be more future expansions for that?
I'm at this very moment, I'm playtesting the sixth faction for the game.
Sixth faction. Imperial Settlers, sixth faction coming soon.
Ooh. Yep, that's true.
Hopefully by Essen, or not.
Hopefully before Essen. Before the Essen is the worst scenario, so if I really delay it, it will be Essen, probably it will be before Essen.
So by Gen Con, you guys are going
to
get...
No, before Gen Con Essen.
By Origins, you guys are going to get a new faction. No. Soon, you're going to get a new faction for Imperial Settlers.
I'm doing my best, but First Martians is the most important project for me, of course.
Yes, so yeah, First Martians is going to be incredible. Now, we played some other games here, didn't we?
Crazy Cards, yes.
Yes, Crazy Cards was a lot of fun, a lot of fun.
Thank you. We have Crazy Cards here, we have a Cry Havoc, I want to play with you, hopefully today or tomorrow, and we have a Tides of Time on Call of Cthulhu, which is, from yesterday, it's called now Tides of Madness.
Tides of Madness.
I contacted my team in Poland, and they say they like the title, so we have a winner.
Zee came up with a title, I see him fist pumping. I like Tentacles of Time, I thought that was kind of cool.
But we have now a new edition.
There too. I like it too.
Tentacles of Time.
Okay. Tides of Madness. Thank you.
Tides of Madness it is. All right.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Ignacy, for coming.
Thank you for having me.
And,
thank you, guys.
We're bringing Ted Alspach in here.
Now introducing Ted Alspach from Bezier Games.
Who's going to make me look really short because he's as tall
as
Thomas.
You're sitting down, I think, Jason.
You're still going to make me look short.
I'm going to run and grab some.
Okay, what are you judging? Someone else? Do you want me to bring my boxes, okay. Jason?
Yeah, right. Of course. We're going to see new games.
I know you're excited about this because,
yes.
Again, we kind of glossed over it. Actually, I don't think we talked about it at all on camera.
No, but I came by. I was at the game night that they had at Gamma where we got to play the games one night. I came by. I went by the table. I'm like, oh, it's the America version of Terra.
Yeah. So it's all it's the pop culture and food and geography and inventions and basically all the cool stuff that the reasons that people like America are in this box.
I love America no matter what.
There we go. Well, the people outside America even like it because of the stuff in this box. So it's very cool. So this is actually one of the first early production copy for me to check to make sure everything's right. So we've got our little America board there the states showing and we have, that's the easy side. The easy side actually will show.
So there's two maps.
Yeah, I mean, they're both America. The easy side actually has the little letter codes for the states, and the hard side doesn't. That's the only difference, really. But this doesn't seem that hard to some people. Other people can't do it. They're like, I have no idea what any of those things are.
Are you going to try to quiz me now to see if I'm smarter or not?
No. We won't do that. It's kind of funny because questions involve answering the correct state. On there. So it comes with enough cards for about 50 games.
Oh, the artwork looks great on that.
And it starts out, this is very cool. One of the very first cards you get to play with is beer.
Beer. And Buffy
and
the Vampire
Slayer.
And
Buffy is on the other side. So Buffy and beer are the cards you can choose from to start the game.
What's more America than Buffy and beer?
Yeah, they really go together well, I think. So.
Yes.
But yeah, all sorts of categories. It's fun. It's got, that whole idea that even if you don't know the answer, you're going to score points because you can basically leech points off of other people who do know the answer. And in America, unlike Terra and Fauna, you can bet against people. You can say, you know what? You're all idiots. Nobody has this right. And get points for that. So that's kind of cool. That's coming out of Gen Con. So that's
pretty
exciting.
That's great. This one. Oh, a new... I wouldn't even call it... A sort of deck builder, like, how would you describe it? Because it's sort of a deck builder-ish kind of
game. Yeah, I mean, it's kind of its own little thing. There's a little, people say, oh, there's a little Dominion or some Magic Coro or even Settlers, actually, because of the resource management and the trading that happens with it. But, it's a building game. I love building games.
Yes.
And everyone's building their own colony that's really cards this time. But to purchase those cards, to get more of them to make your colony bigger, you're using dice as resources. And each number on a dice face is a resource, and they're combined in different ways to be able to purchase things, which give you more abilities to sometimes trade with other people or increase the production of those resources for yourself. And everyone's going to a fixed point total, depending on how many players there are. So you're all racing towards this certain point total, and then as soon as someone reaches it, they win. And
Colony, for those of you that don't know what we're talking about right now.
Sorry, yeah. So
is this another?
And this is a
component. Is this a final?
This is pre.
Pre.
Yeah. This is the homemade. This is my own foam core skill right here. I'm very proud that I'm actually a terrible X-Acto knife cutter.
Oh no, this looks great. This is. I mean, it's it looks like something that Robert Searing would do with his insert here me stuff. Okay, I mean, it looks cool. Just like it. It looks great.
So it's got the thing in here with all the different cards you can have. You only play with seven at a time, but there's 28 different ones in addition to the standard cards you play with, and a little scoreboard, and then a ton.
Lots of dice
and tokens.
I love the crystal dice. Crystal dice always are cool.
Yeah, they're very cool. Yeah, that, and this is an Essen release.
This one's Essen. This one's Essen. It looks great.
That's the show and tell stuff I have here for you. So that's pretty exciting.
So what about other news? Expansions on any more expansions coming out for either like Suburbia or Mad King Ludwig? Or do you have any plans for them in the future?
There's some in the works. There's nothing that we've announced yet. Probably you're not going to see anything like that this year.
What about with your werewolf stuff? I know you just released the Ultimate Vampire.
Yes, One Night Ultimate Vampire just came out a couple months ago, 3 months ago in January, and that's doing really well. Again, nothing to announce on that, but people can look back and see that we're certainly not going to let that go and not do anything more there, because there's a lot of things to explore, and we're playtesting some things right now. And I can tell you that one of the things is so cool that I'm having trouble not telling people on camera what it is.
Well, then tell us now.
I can't do it yet.
Tell us now, because I think Tom wants to make fun of you.
You can't talk about it. It's so awesome. No, we're talking about a one night stuff. The one night.
We're talking about one night
one
stuff.
One night, the next one night. That's coming along.
Since you can't talk about that, I do want to ask real quick, and the folks online are asking about castles. Any more expansions for castles? Anything in the works in that?
Definitely in the works. Big enough.
Whoa.
Couch too small.
Okay.
Couch too small.
You weigh too big.
So here's Mary joining us.
Hi, Mary.
Now.
Hello.
Mary's got a chance to play Colony and America. Why don't you talk about my games?
So you played all the games. Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
You have to. You came and sat with us. Now you have to talk about all Ted's games.
And, you know, this is a great time to petition Aldi to raise the rating cap on BGG to 11, since you're talking about my games. So
these games all go to 11.
But
it would be necessary.
Oh! Wow. Really?
Actually, I really like Colony.
That's nice.
I shouldn't say that in front of you because your head's going to be even bigger.
It can get bigger. It's fun.
Yeah.
No, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed both of the games.
All right. Okay. Yep. And you did really, really well at America. Dead last.
So basically, you must have played on a side where you didn't know what the states were and you couldn't figure out what each state was?
Oh, no. The states were there and the questions were super easy, too.
They were not easy.
Did you never watch Buffy the Vampire Slayer growing up?
No, I was Walking Dead and I don't know anything about Walking Dead.
Out of here. No, Walking Dead. Right, how do you even call yourself a geek? Walking Dead is like geek culture.
Oh, yeah, let's get back to that. There's stuff being worked on, but nothing announced at this point.
This is for castles.
For castles expansion.
Something's being worked on, so we're going to get, like, even more secrets of Mad King Ludwig.
Well, there would be. Yeah, right now they're secret, but they won't be secrets because we've already done the secrets, so it'll be something that will be not a secret.
The blueprints of Mad King Ludwig.
Sure. There we go.
We're going to think of titles. We're just going to see
you can come with the subsidy hit.
Ramble up titles for what this is going to be called. Mary, you want to take a guess on what it's going to be called? New expansion for Mad King Ludwig?
We already have a moat. The battlements.
Battlements. Battlements. Yes, exactly. Where the castles fight each other. You build a castle. Everyone builds a castle, and they throw stuff at each other's castle. Exact dexterity version of the game. Yeah, if your castle stays together and it's all connected, when you're done, you win. I like that. Yeah, we'll just do that.
Yeah, I think it would be cool.
Yeah.
Okay, guys. So this is a question for everyone. We'll just make our way down the line here. Favorite game mechanism.
Favorite game mechanisms. We're going to start with Ted on what his favorite game mechanisms are.
There's a lot. Yeah, it's hard to say favorite. I think one of the things that I don't see enough of is dexterity games. We were just talking about that. I love dexterity games. I'll pick up any of the Zoc stuff that comes out, any big wood block games. I don't care if everyone says it sucks. I don't care. I want big wood blocks and to do fun things with them, balancing them, stacking them, throwing them at each other. I don't care. That's awesome and super fun.
He wants to play the blocks.
I do. I don't know. There's something about that. That's just great. So I love Dexterity games, and I don't think there's enough of them being made right now. So it's a broad mechanism, but it's something I want to see a lot more of, because hand-eye coordination, while I still have it, I want to take advantage of it and use it.
Oh, you still have it.
Yeah.
I like worker placement and engine building. It's my favorites. I know, boring, but...
No, nothing's boring about that. My favorite is, like, tech tree. Anything with a tech tree in it, I think, is awesome. So I love games with tech trees where you're, like, building up your technology and games like that.
Yep.
And deck builders, like Colony.
Man.
I love deck builders. Deck builders are great.
I mean, the correct answer for you guys would have been, like, I think, Tile Lane, Hidden Rolls.
Yes.
Hidden Rolls.
Yes,
I know
Hidden
Marin
Rolls.
Loves werewolf stuff, so... yeah, that's what I would suggest you guys.
Do you want to ask that about what's the backstory in Colony?
Backstory.
Awesome. That's a great question, because I'm really excited about this. So it has this incredibly rich backstory. So everyone knows.
Say Colony.
I did. The backstory of Colony. Z's now making sure that I do my job of repeating the questions.
That's right. They can't do it. Backstory
so,
of Colony.
Ted, tell us the backstory of Colony.
All right. Thanks, Jason. So here we are. It's the year 2016. We all know nanotechnology is on the verge of exploding, right? It's going to happen, right? And we also know that as a result of that, within 10 years, there will be a nanopocalypse. Those nanobots will destroy the world. We know it's going to happen. We just don't know exactly when. I'm betting 2025. That's basically when I say the world will end, because the nanobots will basically take over and destroy everything.
So we have like 9 years to go.
Yeah, which is cool. That's fine. I'm good with that. So basically when that happens, a few of us who are ready for it, we're going to be basically getting ourselves underground, sealed off, and ready to go. You know, we've got all our end-of-the-world supplies and things like that in our bunkers. All right, generations later, about 80 years or so later, we'll emerge. Hopefully the nanobots will have been gone, and we'll rebuild. And that's where Colony comes into play. You are rebuilding, and you're starting with a small colony, where you're building up again using the resources you can find from the devastation that's happened after the nanopocalypse.
And there haven't been a lot of dice.
Let me ask him one more quick question here. What's coming, what's happening from Bezier at Origins?
Yes, Origins, what's happening at Origins? What are you releasing?
So at Bezier at Origins, we actually don't have a release. We are, America's coming out at Gen Con, and Colony is coming out at Essen. So we don't have an Origins release, sadly.
Cool.
Yeah.
Right, very sad. With Jason now.
Yes.
That's not going to work for us.
Z's coming in here.
Is it 10 o'clock yet?
Exactly.
All right.
Yes, here comes Z. He's going to join in.
Okay.
I'm stepping out. Here comes Z. He's awake now.
Finally awake enough to do this.
Hello. Yes.
All right. How you doing,
Ted? I am doing well. See, how are you?
I'm good.
Welcome to the gathering.
Welcome to the couch.
How's the gathering been for you so far?
It's been good. It's my first year here.
Yeah, playing lots of games?
I did, actually, yeah. Yeah. And it's funny because the very first game I played was a deep, long, economic Euro game. So it was like, hi, welcome to the gathering. Deep end of the
awesome.
Pool, you know?
Awesome.
It's like, whoa. Nice. But it was like, okay, it put me in game mode. You know, it triggered that thing where I'm like, okay, I'm ready to play some games.
It's nice. I don't know if you told people that over the side here, we have people playing Democker, which
is
kind of cool. Because
I'm
going
to go over there once this is done and then jump right in.
Yeah. That's kind of sweet. I'm like, I could use 4 hours of German elections.
Yeah. Sounds great.
What sparked your love of gaming?
We're talking to Z.
We're talking to both of us. Go for it.
We are
talking about what sparked our love of gaming.
Yes.
So we're going to listen to
for me,
tell us about.
Certainly
he's going to talk about love and spark on this couch sitting here with me.
No, that's my parents. My parents played games when I was too little to play. I have memories of them going to other couples' houses and playing games like Life and Monopoly and cards and stuff like that, and people come to our house and doing the same thing. And so, you know, it's nice, it's kind of cool to continue that tradition and having our kids see that same sort of thing where people are getting together and playing games. So it started there, and my parents played games with me, and my grandfather played games with me, and then, you know, all the way through. So, you know, certainly pretty much since birth there's been games involved.
Right.
So,
right.
Yeah, it's part of life.
I think for me, when I was really little, I wanted to game. but I had A, no other people that wanted to play games with me, and B, no games, because I had no access to games. So I really got into gaming more in high school, and it was sort of from a party point of view. You know, it was like the crappy, like Toys R Us, really, like, you know, cannibalistic sort of games that are on those shelves. So I got into it that way, and then very quickly started discovering, okay, games can be a little bit less sort of just pedantic and obvious as these games. So that's the thing, how I got into it. So yeah, party games was my way in there.
Yeah, I think not enough credit is given to your friendly local game store employees who actually know what they're talking about.
Oh, sure.
Because those folks are what got me back into the, at the time, much more of the cult hobby when it was a lot quieter in the 90s and the early 2000s. I was, a friend of mine had introduced me to some Steve Jackson games that I just had never seen in the 80s. And I was excited about that, went to a game store, asked about purchasing them. And they said, the one that I had wanted, I forgot which one it was, but it was out of stock, and they could order it for me. I'm like, okay, there's the internet, I could probably do that, but that was 90s, so it's sketchy.
Right.
But they did point me to the Catan box, and I'm like, that is an ugly, ugly looking box. You sure this is fun? He goes, oh, you want to play it, you'll like it. So I actually learned Catan from the rules, which I don't know if anyone else has done that, but that is horrible. That is a horrendous way to learn the game, because it's such a simple game when it's taught to you. It can be taught to you in 10 minutes.
Right, right.
And it's at the time, you're like, oh, that's amazing, mind-blowing. But boy, trying to learn from the rules.
I learned from the rules also. It's very funny because you have the rule book, and then you have something called an almanac, and you're like, what is this? An almanac? Am I farming? What is that? Am I actually farming? It was very, very confusing. I've never seen a rule book do that before.
That's the way it is still, right?
I'm sure. I don't even know anymore. I'm sure it is.
I don't know the last time I looked up a rule in Settlers, but anyway, that kicked off things, and then, you know, you go back to the game store and you see other things they have there, and then BGG popped up, and you're like, oh, look at all the different things that are there that I've missed, and... Yeah, you go crazy then.
Yeah, my switch was from party games. The first game I got that sort of just blew my mind was Carcassonne. I got that, and I was like, okay, I opened it up, and then it dawned on me that I was playing a board game in which I built the board as I played the game. And I know that sounds silly now, but imagine, like, the first time you played a deck-building game, and you're like, okay, this is a game in which you have a deck of cards, and you build the deck while you play. It was that sort of like, it's a game that the board is destroyed and I'm rebuilding it while I play it, and it just blew my mind. I was like, okay, this is
when people experience that, who are used to the more traditional games, it's like their brain suddenly switches into a new direction, that they can see suddenly that, oh, that's games can be so different than this small subset that I think they could be party games and traditional Hasbro style games.
Right. Games. Yeah. What do you got over there, blue hat?
Hey, what's going on, Tom? Hey, what are your favorite dexterity game?
My favorite dexterity game? Probably Bambaleo. That's the Zoc one with the big platter. And of course, I have both editions that has one's the round, big yellow platter, and then there's one that's kind of a weird, unusual rectangle, curved rectangle one.
New pretzel one here?
I have not, but I've seen it. I saw it played, and I definitely won too. I was busy as I was walking by, but that looks awesome.
The pieces look great for
The one I like, I think my favorite dexterity game is probably this really stupid Hoppa game where you, with the bear, what is that one called?
What,
where the bear is like carrying a...
Animal upon animal?
No. Animal upon animal is and everyone knows and everyone's played, but there's another one with a little bear and he carries wooden discs of varying sizes.
Oh, I've seen that, yes.
Yeah, so you put a disc on him, and you have to pick up the bear with a bunch of discs and move him a certain distance, and then you put another disc on for the next person, and it's like, you know, and it's one of those things that very quickly you're going, oh, don't breathe. Oh, it's for kids, but it's a good time for adults.
Speaking of Hoppa games and dexterity, Schnapp, if you've never played Schnapp, it's been out of print for probably 20 years now. Oh, what an awesome, awesome game. And, Tom, you'll like this. It's good for tall people.
Crokinole?
What? Crokinole's great. Yeah, I love Crokinole. But Schnapp, basically, you flip discs up into the air, and you flip them when they're upside down. You don't see what color they are until they start flipping. and you have to grab the one that's your color. You have to grab it if it's your color.
No way.
And you have four people doing this. And again, if you're tall and you have long arms and some skill, you can crush other people. So it is definitely, I love that game. Yeah.
Last question for you.
That sounds cool.
Why do publishers feel the need to be secretive about stuff?
It's
a question people always wonder about.
Sure, sure. I think it depends. I think part of it is it's for marketing purposes. It's, I think it. Oh, sorry.
Oh, what was it?
Why do publishers feel the need to be secretive?
Okay, the question is why do publishers feel the need to be secretive instead of just telling you, hey, this is coming?
Because things happen. I guess, there's games that I'm working on that I think are going to be out at a certain point, and things can happen. It's, production issues, development issues. I mean, you can get to a place where you go, oh my gosh, there's a big issue with this game that we're not going to be able to, we have to fix this before we can publish it. It's not going to make it at this time. For anyone who's, there are games that have been announced for years and years and years that don't show up, and there's a little anticipation about that, but there's these expectations grow to be kind of phenomenal, and they might not actually do what the game is, what it turns out to be. So I try not to ever announce something until it's 95% done. I'm really close to that till I know how much it's going to cost, till I know what the components will be inside of a game.
It's just so you have more information, basically.
Yeah.
It's partly, I'm sure, also to sort of keep those expectations, like you're saying, in check a little bit, and be able to control the arc of excitement, if you would. It's like, okay, I'm going to tell you, say, 2 months, so that arc starts to peak and peak and peak, and right when it's at its, peak there, game drops and comes out, and everybody's, or you ride that wave, and then eventually it's like, okay, people have moved on to other, news. Then your game comes out, and you kind of miss that.
Right, and
that wave
if I don't have a launch date for a game, if I don't know when it should be out within a month or so, I don't want to talk about it yet because it's fuzzy, and people have that expectation. And game stores are interested in certain things or not. But it's. I think you have to wait a certain amount of time, and it's not that it's a super secret, but at the same time, the more you tell people, and it gets out there, and there's a little buzz about something related, and especially if it's something people like One Night, if there's a One Night game coming out, people want to know, what that is and where it is, and then there's these big expectations for it, and maybe a role or something I thought was cool at the time didn't make it in. I was just talking to Jason, I'm like, oh, there's a really cool thing we're playtesting. Right now it kind of works, but maybe we find out later that there's too many things wrong with it or there's just some issue with it that just doesn't make it, and then I've already told people it's going to be there, and then it's not,
And it's not like with games, it's not like with movies, right? I mean, with movies, a year before the movie comes out, you know the day you can go and get it, or see it. It's not the same. With games, there's too many,
Oh, yeah, there's a lot of moving parts.
The way, from everything to your hands, there's a lot of steps where things could take longer.
Totally. Yeah. And so, nothing like that is actually announced usually. Sometimes if I'm playtesting stuff that's, it's open, and so people say, well, I'd rather you didn't take pictures because it's never going to look like this afterwards.
Of course.
And I don't have a name for it. It's going to be maybe sometime in the future. That's fine. But once I know I'm going to publish it, but I'm not quite sure of all the details yet, I kind of want to wait until I have that. And then, when I have all the details, I want to get it to Dice Tower News, for instance, and get it to people so that I'd say that everyone's going to announce it on the same time, also, which is kind of the fair thing to do so that someone doesn't feel like they're scooped. Tom shaking his head, he doesn't care. He's like, it scooped me. Yeah. some people care. So, try and get it all out and say, this is when we're announcing. We're going to announce on the website. You can announce it then or later. We don't care. Podcasts and things like that.
Yeah.
Kind of have it all done at one time, so it's kind of a consistent message too. So they're getting the same thing and they're seeing similar shots of the game.
Right. Get it in everybody's heads.
Final art.
Cool.
All right.
Thanks, man. Good talking
to
you. I know the audio thing. Oh my goodness. Interwebs. I'm telling you guys. Headphones. I know they have a little R and a little left. Just switch them. Switch them, bad boys. All right. I'll move. Hey, Mary. You get to sit with Mike. I get to sit with Mike Fitzgerald.
I never miss a review of your stuff.
It's too sweet. You need Mike Fitzgerald.
People still want to talk about CCGs. I guess they're still coming out, aren't they? I don't know whether we can talk about the one Tom and I were mentioning, but there are CCGs coming out.
Here, clip this on. Look, I did, Mike. Like, just fold the shirt and clip it on okay. So it's not rubbing up against your beard or anything.
Good, yeah, that'll work. So, well, I did four of them. I don't know how great they were. It's very hard, right? It's very hard to do them. You talk about how hard legacy games are. Doing collectible card games is very hard. You can never test enough, and I think that's probably true with legacy too, because the paths and what can happen with combinations of cards is so difficult. For me, it was always trying to be original in some way. I mean, my first one was Wyvern. Now it was very different, right? There was no mana, everything was Magic at that time, and it was one of the early ones. So I didn't want to do anything like Magic, but I wanted it to be collectible, and so I made it really Stratego with giant growth, as some people call it, which is what it is, really. But anyway, it was different, and that got me noticed in the business. I mean, the game did okay, too, because it was so hot to have a trading card game in those days, and then when we had the glut, everything sort of died, except Magic, Pokemon, Yu-Gi-Oh! Coming out was strong, but a lot of the others were struggling. But it's very difficult. When I did Nitro, the wrestling game for Wizards of the Coast, I had this mechanic where cards, as you're taking damage, you're milling your deck, and certain cards will strike the other guy back right away. In your hand, they're not that great, but you want them to be hit when the guy's.
So do you think that's what it is then? That it's having one original, real original mechanic, one original idea is the way into good CCG?
For me as a designer, that was it. I wouldn't do just another one.
Right.
So each one I did, I tried to bring something original. And what you don't know in the end is how it's going to work with players and how it's so, you know, I just think it's a very difficult thing to do.
They are kind of making a little bit of a comeback. Why do you think that is?
I have no idea. Maybe it's been so long that companies forget the nightmare of trying to produce one of these and keep up. Hmm. It's a nightmare whether it's a hit or it's a failure. Now, a hit, there's a nice part of that nightmare, right? But then you have to keep feeding it, and you have to do expansions, and you have to support tourneys, and you have to do organized play, and all of a sudden...
Tom is saying,
oh, no, no.
Don't most designers pass that off to other designers anyway? You know, there's a team that built around them.
I'm talking about the publisher. Like, the question was, why are they being published? Are they coming back, right? So I'm thinking from the publisher's viewpoint. From a designer's viewpoint, if you want to do one, go ahead. I've done all I'm doing. But I do games. I mean, deck building just kind of has some of that to it.
Sure.
Living card games have some of that to it.
They kind of took that pie and split it up into smaller pieces, and they're like, okay, you can have this piece, you can have this piece.
I guess I should never say never, but I don't have any plans to do a CCG.
Tom is asking us here that you guys asked, are there any upcoming plans for either Mystery Rummy series or what was the other one?
Baseball Highlights.
Yeah, both. I mean, Baseball Highlights, I was just in Albuquerque, New Mexico. A little shout out to the Dukes of Dice, who Alex and Sean hosted a Baseball Highlights tournament for the first week of baseball. We had 16 players at the Empire Board Game Library, which if you're ever going through Albuquerque, you have to see it. It's a wonderful game cafe. And so that game is one of these strange games that every month it just kind of has this groundswell, you know?
Really?
It's not one of these, I mean, most games I think they peak a little bit early and then, you know, they get a nice steady if they're good enough or they eventually fade away.
Right.
I mean, baseball is a weird theme for a hobby board game, certainly, and a lot of people have to get past that, and so I didn't know whether it would do anything or not, really. I mean, I love doing it, and I love the game, but I didn't know what would happen. But we find now that as people give it a try, there's enough groundswell, enough buzz with people on the geek and stuff, who these fans just will do crazy. Well, the people that are watching. I mean, you guys will do crazy things that really support games and help us all. And, man, we couldn't do it without that support. So, yes, expansions. I'm working on something that may be a standalone, little different setting at times. I mean, and some of that depends on how it goes in the future, but every month it just keeps selling more than the previous month. I mean, it's just one of these strange things that has a groundswell. Mystery Rummy.
Good problem to have.
Yeah, Mystery Rummy. Yes, I'll talk about it now, what I'm doing. It has not been signed yet. You know, it's funny because companies, like Ted was saying, have to be careful about what they say. I can tell you a little bit about this. I'm doing a Legacy style Mystery Rummy game. Now, it's not real Legacy. At this point, things aren't being destroyed. And I'm not sure what makes a legacy game different from a game that evolves and changes. The game changes. And at the end of your set number of episodes, sort of like a TV series, you have a game you can keep playing. So that's different from Legacy. I figure with a card game, it's going to be a little bit shorter, a little tighter with just cards, and there is a small board, that it'd be fun if players had something to play at the end.
So my copy of the game when I'm done will be different from your copy when you're done,
right? Oh, yes. In fact, it may be, there's three different games that can evolve depending on how your journey goes. Wow. Three different types of games, put it that way.
Wow, okay.
So, and now that's a great concept, right? People say, oh, wow, well, let's see if I can execute it. That's what I'm trying to do.
That's the tricky part.
That's the hard part. But, yeah, so both Mystery Rummy and Baseball Highlights, they do well for me, so I'm going to feed them as much as I can.
You bet. Yeah, I'm a big Mystery Rummy fan.
Oh, thank you.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
that's, it's...
For both of you, what's your favorite combination of mechanisms?
Favorite combination of mechanisms. I like worker placement games a lot, but I tend to not be a big fan of worker placement games, and that's it. So something else in there, like worker placement and area majority, that's solid. I just played a game here from Jay Cormier, I think his name is, in San Fun Lim. That is the mafia game, the Godfather game. And it's area control and worker placement, dice based. Great combination. So I would have to say worker placement and something else. The second thing could be area control, but it could be anything else, really. I don't even care. I mean, it could be dexterity and work replacement. But I'd like that combination because I like that way of taking actions. I'm also a big fan of card drafting. So if you could have a board with some actions, like, and then some work replacement on there and involving some card drafting, like Notre Dame. Have you ever played Notre Dame?
I love Stefan
Feltz. It's that, right? It's got some card drafting, but then you get to do some stuff on the board.
There are two games by Stefan Feltz I love. I'm not a typical Euro gamer. You know, the others are fine. He's a great designer. But the ones that do it for me are Notre Dame and Roma.
You are speaking my language right now.
I know. I watch your videos.
Yeah.
I know. But Roma. I think those are great.
Notre Dame and Roma.
Yeah. And, you know, but the others, not my style. My favorite mechanism is hand management. I do card games, right? But I mean really favorite because, for me, it's the challenge of, in playing a game, I'm trying to accomplish something. Winning or losing doesn't really matter much to me anymore.
Sure.
It's nice when I win, but I'm really trying to make the best of whatever situation I'm put in. And with good card games or good games that involve a mix of cards, you're set with a different challenge right away every time, and I love that. The other one would be, I guess, I don't know if this is a real mechanism, but combinations that just sort of blow your mind, you know, like, and that's why I'm such a Carl Chetti fan. Mm-hmm. I love Matainai and stuff, because there's just, and for 54 cards, I've played 300-400 times, I still see things I haven't seen before.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Hand management, crazy combos, that's my sweet spot. Oh, boy.
Tom,
I get asked this all the time.
Will we see football 2044?
You know, I've been asked to do it. It's funny because some people say it has to be that same mechanic. You know, the little mechanic in Baseball Highlights, immediate action,
that
threat.
That
came about because I was doing a baseball game.
Right.
And it's funny because Tom Lehman and some other people are really excited about the mechanic. And they say, well, we're going to do it in lots of games, and you better because we will. I said, go for it. To me, it works for baseball. I'm not sure what else it'll work for. I have tried it with football, and in my opinion, that mechanic doesn't work for football. I'm not sure I want to do a football game of this type. I am looking at some unusual sports, let's put it that way, or an unusual take, maybe more futuristic stuff that's so different. Yes, exactly.
That Harry Potter sport, what is the... Tom said Mongolian goat, whatever, and What's the Harry Potter catch the snitch?
Quidditch.
Quidditch. Quidditch. That's the one. You do Quidditch.
Which is a terrible game.
I mean, sure seems that way.
The game is broken.
Pretty sure.
Quidditch is completely
garbage
game. Broken.
It's like, everybody just let me catch this thing.
That's right.
You're good. Give me a sec. What else you got? Bring it, interwebs.
Yes, I can talk about this. Crash.
So Tom asked, taken Rummy and made a line out of it, really. And you've done some classic trick taking and then evolved it and made your own line. Any other classics that you are
thinking of tackling? Well, I did do a game that wasn't that successful, but I really wanted to do it. And I did base one on the old Italian card game Casino called Sloop.
Sure.
Now, Sloop does well in Europe, actually, for Amigos. It's called Quanto.
Okay.
But it's very simple. It's a row
so
of cards.
So Casino, where you like where you trail a card and
yes,
you can
exactly.
match up and you
exactly.
can build.
So
yeah, sure.
I blew
I
it
like
up
Casino
into
a
sort
lot.
Of a big deck game. So Sloop, I did. But I can announce the latest because Crash of Games is releasing it at Essen, Pat Nickel. And now it's Crash of Games. It's
That's
not
right, right.
Crash Games anymore. So it is based on cribbage. And I love cribbage since I was a kid. But it's a little wonky and a little fiddly as a modern game, right? I mean, if you've ever played it.
Sure.
But I did take the one element I've always loved from cribbage, which is the fact that your hands, again, it's hand management, your selection of hand is going to score in three different ways. It's the same cards. So I took that. That's the only thing in the game that's reminiscent of cribbage, but it's there. And so for people who played a lot of cribbage, they get it. Yeah. For people who haven't, they, oh, this is original. Where'd you get this idea? So it wasn't me. It's been around for a long time.
So it's a brand new game?
Brand new game. It comes out. Now, I call it Scorecards. That's sort of the working title. That will not be the title when it comes out. And I don't know what they're going to call it, actually. But every card in the game scores when you play it, depending on the situation on the board. And there's three different phases we put people in. And it's kind of a sprint to win those. But that, yes, so I am doing that for cribbage.
Sounds good.
Yes, thank you, guys.
All right, good talking to you, Mike.
His favorite spot?
Always a pleasure, sir.
Yes.
All right, thanks. This couch really sucks you in, doesn't it? I just want to stay here all day.
We're just going to drag a table up and play games. Okay, we have a question, and then Jason will ask some more. But the question was, why do all reviews start the same way?
I did see that.
Why do you show how the game works and then explain it or then give your opinion on it?
I mean, I think it's because it's both expected. That's part of it, which is not a big deal, I guess, because, you know, expectations can be broken and you can discover something new that's interesting. I think it's because I need to accomplish a few things when I do a review anyway. I need to introduce what I'm doing. Because it's weird for me to go like a shot of the table and I start explaining a game and you're going, what's happening? So basic structure, okay? I need to introduce it. And then I need to tell you about it. And so you know what I'm going to be giving you my opinion on and you can kind of follow along and go, ooh, no, that looked great, and he's saying it looked bad. He's wrong, and that's valuable information. If you find you disagree with me, that's as valuable to you as if you find you agree with me. It doesn't matter if you do or don't, because at the end of the day, I'm just giving you information as to let you know, hey, this is a game I want to own, or hey, I want to try that game. So that's why I have to show it to you first. And then tell you what I think. So you've got a point of reference. Me just telling you, which is why those questions are so weird, right? When people go, hey, should I buy this game? I have no idea what you like. If you want to ask me, hey, should you Z buy that game? I'll tell you. But how would I know if you should buy that game? I have no idea what your tastes are. That's why I have to show you the game.
Right. And I mean, there's people like, well, you know, everyone's doing the same thing. Well, a couple things there. First of all, we were doing it before a whole lot of people were doing it. And I don't feel like I should change necessarily because other people did. I do try to change things up, like I'm starting to do my reviews outside.
Yeah.
And different things like that. But I think I want my review to be useful. I don't want my review to win a Pulitzer Prize or, you know, wow, that was artistically done. That was funny. there's a place for that sort of thing. But for me, I want the review to be useful, and I don't believe a review can be useful if you don't know how the game is played. Again, if I just sit there and gave my opinion, well, that's great. And I've seen reviews where I get the opinion, and I'm like, well, that's great, but how does the game work? That didn't help me.
Right.
So I just do my reviews the way I would want them.
And again, that's not to say we're going to teach you. I certainly do not even attempt to teach you how the game plays, as in you can watch my video, then go play. No. There's things left out. There's things I might have said wrong as I was explaining it. That doesn't mean I played wrong. It means I'm just running my mouth, showing you all this stuff, and I said something wrong, which I'll try to catch later and try to fix and whatever, but, you know, it happens. So you should not learn from our... I'm just showing you enough to, again, give you kind of the ability to follow me along. It's like putting up a PowerPoint and talking. You know, that's what I'm doing.
So here's a very interesting question that the two of you guys here together is, would you think of doing a Breakfast Blender crossover episode?
People want to know if we're going to do a Breakfast Blender crossover episode. Isn't it? It's kind of really weird that I've actually never thought of that. Have you thought of it? Because I never even crossed my mind.
No. What would it be?
Mega breakfast buffet.
Board game buffet? What? I mean, no, but I mean, what would it even be? My show hinges on a theme.
Well, we could say this week we're going to combine the whole
show. That was kind of like the one thing I brought. I mean, hopefully I brought some more things to it. But when you brought me on, part of what you wanted was a sister show to Breakfast, right?
But it's an interesting concept. I'll consider it.
Yeah, that was your thing. That was your, okay, I would like you to do a sister show. And so I think the biggest thing I came up with that made it different was I said, okay, I'm going to have it be theme-based. So combining it, maybe do a theme. We could do that. We could do a show where it's my show structure with all of your people. And you could do your show structure with all of my people.
Oh, it's even weirder. Like that like crossover?
And I'll run the breakfast and you run the blender.
We'll see. We'll see.
So basically it's going to be Q&A with Jason and Zee from now on.
There you go. Jason's in it anyway, right? It's like
everyone's curious about those socks.
They're just regular black socks.
No, not those socks. They're asking about the socks that one person said.
People are asking about Tom's hot dog socks.
Oh, it's a hot dog. They said they were corn dogs with mustard.
There.
And he just took his shoe off.
Where did you get the socks?
I
want to know where he got the socks and
I subscribed to the
socks. Why?
Yeah, because, well, why? I like them. But I got a foot cardigan. It's a
foot cardigan.
It's a
I'm subscriber.
Monthly
right now.
Subscription.
It's
I
like
get
a
pair
box.
Of socks.
It's like one
month.
Of those like box of stuff, right?
My kids really like these hot dog socks. I got popcorn socks. I got 8-ball socks, Christmas socks, Valentine. I love it. I love it. I wish there was a way to subscribe and get two different pairs of socks.
You want a subscription box for hats.
That'd
you
be
would be
amazing.
On that like white on rice.
You know what? I'm not so sure because I just ordered four. I was doing hats, and there was like a, get four fedoras was a really cheap price. Four random fedoras. I was like, yay, and I got them, and I don't really like them that much.
Garbagey, yeah.
When you pick the actual hat, it's better, but socks, I don't care, so.
Yeah, okay, I can see that.
So, actually, you've got names now, the blended breakfast or the board game smoothie.
All right, give us a question.
The board game smoothie.
That's
are there any plans to do a third variety show down the road or adding more variety shows?
No comment. What else we got?
Well,
someone was asking,
question.
Is there a plan to do a third variety show? And my answer is no comment.
Smoothie is coming. We'll start throwing advertising up. Smoothie.
What are your thoughts on Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2?
What are your thoughts on Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2, the movie?
Did that come out this weekend? Did that come out?
Oh, here's where my head was at. I'm thinking, why is that even... That movie came out in like 91. Okay, the new one just came out. See, this is how out of the loop I am with these movies.
I have not seen it. I will probably see it when it comes out in video.
I saw the first one and I was not that impressed. Did you like it?
It was okay.
Yeah? Yeah, I didn't like
it. My kids liked it more than me.
Sure. It felt like it was made with leftover, like, Michael Bay pieces and that they digitally inserted the turtles into, so. Yeah.
Okay, so, do you have more thoughts about your top 10 mechanisms?
Do you have more thoughts about your top 10 mechanisms?
Have I thought more about my top 10 mechanisms? Did we do a top 10 mechanisms
list? I don't
know.
Did we do that? Top 10 mechanisms?
Well, maybe we did.
I forget what I do almost immediately, so I don't know. But while he's looking that up, what
yeah. So then the answer would be no, since
we have not thought any more about it.
I think about my favorite mechanisms, and that will be a top 10 list. If we haven't done it, we will do it. This week we're doing our top 10 games that scale well. I'm excited about that.
Play well with all the listed numbers, and that'll be fun.
And we're also in our top 10 movies that we think need a sequel.
Yeah, top
probably 10 movies. The most useless top 10 ever.
But it's fun to talk about it. And hopefully it's more like, hey, you know, come
well,
hang out with us.
Well, you already spoiled it because now people know that TMNT is not the...
That's not it. No, it's fun. You'll be like you're sitting there with us just chatting, you know. And I'm also doing a top 10 solitaire games. I know some people ask about that.
That may be gone up today, maybe?
Finally. That comes out Wednesday? Tuesday?
Yeah, today or tomorrow. Today is Tuesday.
Yeah.
The question is, what is your reaction to Amazingly Star Wars Rogue One trailer.
Is that what the question says? I think that was paraphrased. People want to know what's our reaction to the Star Wars Rogue One trailer is. Pretty much, I mean, it was jaw-dropping, really. First of all, I was surprised that they gave us more than like a second of footage. But that looks better than Episode 7, I thought.
Wow.
It just looks better.
It's what they're calling a teaser that feels like a whole trailer. It's much better than the stuff that they first dropped about Episode 7. I don't know if it looks better than Episode 7 because I've seen it.
It has AT-ATs.
Like, I've seen the whole movie, right? So, but if I was going to say first thing you saw about Rogue One and the first thing you saw about Episode 7, this blows that stuff out of the water. Because it used to be that whole, like, there has been an awakening. Boom, bam, you're done. And you're like, what's happening? This is like a full trailer. This is...
You know what I'm hoping is? I'm hoping that there's no Jedi in this movie. That'd be kind of cool.
I'm pretty sure there's... Oh, Jedi. Yeah, it's possible.
There might not be. That'd be interesting.
Just Rebels and then the...
Why not?
Yeah. So, it looks great. I really liked it, too. I loved it.
What's the game that we will see played next?
No, Shay said, what's the next game we're going to see play live? In May, we're going to have Rodney Smith and Steven Buonocore going to come down and play games. I do not know what the games are because...
And you get to watch it played?
It's...
Sorry, I apologize for that lame joke.
We're going to make Rodney teach all the rules for the games.
Very
okay.
Slowly in his...
I don't know what those are. That's actually our next thing to work on after Gathering of Friends is that... we will probably do some other games live. You will see today and tomorrow. You can watch a recorded playthrough of Time Stories, Prophecy of Dragons. So that's going up today and tomorrow. We already recorded those. And I would imagine next week, once we get back in the swing of things, you'll see a couple more live games. We're definitely going to do some more of those Us Versus the Internet thing. I want to do some of that, but again... It's just been a crazy month in all. Gamma took up a lot of our time, Gathering. Now that Gathering's over in May, we're only going to Culminator Knot Convention, and that's not as time intensive for us.
Sure.
So we'll.
But there's a lot of stuff out there for you guys for this week. At the very, you know, certainly, with all the top tens, all the reviews, all of this. I know I'm going to be tweeting out pictures. I assume you're doing some tweeting and all of that.
Yeah.
I'm going to be doing some periscoping. If you're watching this live right now, then, just stay tuned for all
that
stuff.
Yes, so we're going to end on that. So next we're going to do this again on Thursday at 9 o'clock, and then we're probably going to do it again on Saturday at 9. I think every other day is good. I will try to have some other publishers. There's a lot of publishers and designers here. We might get Eric Lang and Friedman Fries and Vlado Shvato, and I don't know who we'll be able to get, okay, because I have to be able to talk to them and get it done ahead of time. But look forward to the next one at 9 a.m. on Thursday. So thank you to Mike Fitzgerald and Ted Alspach and Steven Buonocore and Ignacy Trebuchek and Jason Levine and Mary Prasad and Zee Garcia and me. Thanks for watching the Dice Tower Live. Until next time, I'm Tom Vassell.
Zee Garcia, thanks everybody.
And we'll see you then.
And there's Jason over there saying, awesome, awesome, awesome. This game.